piece of commutative algebra. It will be another criterion for certain O-algebras to be complete intersections. And this criterion, you will find it in the paper by Taylor and Wiles. And the version that I will give is an improvement of the original criterion due to Taylor and Wiles, which appears in the appendix to that paper. Almost all the key ideas of the argument, however, you find already in the paper by Taylor and Wiles. So let me set up the notation. Like yesterday, O is a complete discrete valuation ring. But unlike yesterday, this time I insist that its residue field is finite. So the basic example, however, is the same. You can think of ZP. And I assume that I have a surjective map of two complete Noetherian O algebras, and I want them to both to be pointed in the sense of yesterday, so there is a commutative diagram of this sort, and all these maps are also surjective. So on T, we put one further condition. T is supposed to be finite and free. So the example that you should have in mind is, and that will be the main application of the criterion, is that you have a representation of the Galois group of Q bar over Q with values in, let's say, the P torsion points of an elliptic curve. And you have a modular lift of that. So you have a lift, so that gives rise to a representation with values in GL2O, and this lift is modular. So you have a modular form with coefficients in O. And as I explained to you yesterday, those are exactly the two examples that I gave that give naturally rise to these pointed algebras. This map comes then from the universal property of the deformation ring. This will be, so R will then be a deformation ring, which is in some sense, as will be explained in the other talks, minimal. This is the minimal case, the case of a minimal deformation. And T is a ring that is made up of Hecke operators. And this is then the map that comes from the universal property. It will be shown that if these rings are properly chosen, that there is a surjection from the deformation ring to the Hecke algebra. This is the map that comes from the universal property of the deformation ring, and this will be the map that comes from the modular form. And we have such a commutative diagram. But it will be minimal. Whatever that may mean, that will be explained in other talks. And in fact, the criterion that I proved yesterday for you will be used to go from the minimal case to the non-minimal cases. So that's the basic example. Now, the point is to show what you would like is that this map F is an isomorphism, because if you have that, then you have shown that the deformation ring is a Hecke ring, and that translates into the fact that all deformations of a certain type are modular, in particular the one that you were after. So that is what the criterion is about, so let me write it here. So theorem. So it's due to Wiles and improved by Falkings. Wow. Suppose there exists an integer n, which is at least one, a universal integer, r. And suppose that, so far the theorem is, this condition is satisfied. And suppose that for integers n, 1, 2, 3, for all positive integers, I have a diagram of O S1 up to SR algebras that looks like this. Here I have with surjective arrows O S1 up to SR algebra, homomorphisms to be precise, that looks like this. Now I should tell you in which way I turn these O algebras, R and T, into O S1 up to SR algebras. And that's very easy. You just let S1 up to SR act as zero. Let me write it here. So, suppose we have that, such that now, the properties will be on the next blackboard. Well, there are three properties. The first property says that the rings Rn and Tn are related in a more precise sense to the rings R and T. It says that if I take the ring Rn, so that maps surjectively to R, and since the action of these variables is trivial on R, that means that the action factors through this quotient, and I want that this is an isomorphism. So that map induces an isomorphism, and the same for the T's. So it should be, that should be the relations between the Rn's and the R's. The second and the third property, they say something of the following sort. You should view these rings R and T a little bit like this, is that T is a small sort of nice finite and flat or finite and free O algebra. It's small. While R is something you really don't know much about. It is a deformation ring. It is quite mysterious. You can compute its tangent space, and so you know it is Noetherian, but for the rest, it could a priori be very, very large. And in fact, there is a surjection in that direction. So the next two conditions sort of give you the information of the opposite sort. The first condition tells you that R is in some sense, or the Rn's are in some sense small. And they are generated by, as O algebras, by R variables. So there is a surjection from this power series ring to Rn, just as complete O algebras. And R is the universal, is the integer that is in the beginning. And the third condition says that in some sense the Tn's are large. And that is as follows: the ring Tn, the O algebra Tn, is finite and free over that algebra there. Modulo J for some small and finite free, and well, it's automatically non-zero, so finite and free over this ring for a small ideal J, for some J, which is an ideal of this ring, which is contained in the ideal generated by omega n s1 up to omega n sr. And omega n is just Iwasawa theory shorthand for the following polynomial. Omega n of s is just 1 plus s to the p to the n minus 1. So if you this ideal is for instance, no, you've never seen this, if I take this algebra O S1 up to SR and I divide it by that ideal there, then this is isomorphic to a group ring. This is isomorphic to O G, where G is a finite abelian group, which is isomorphic to R copies of Z mod n. That is the property of this ideal, and in fact that's how it will arise. Okay, still there's no conclusion, I believe. So we have all these diagrams and we have all these conditions, and the conclusion is that if you have that F is an isomorphism, and both these rings are complete intersections. Okay. Now, Udi de Chalet, in his two talks, will prove the existence of such diagrams. R will again be some kind of a deformation ring. It will sort of be a deformation of a deformation ring. And Tn will be some kind of a Hecke algebra. And the Chalet will prove that if you can very cleverly choose certain deformation rings and certain Hecke algebras such that all these conditions are satisfied. And the number R will be the dimension of a certain cohomology group, of a certain H1. So let me make a few remarks. First of all, there is not at all... There is no compatibility between the several diagrams here. It is just a collection of diagrams that are completely unrelated a priori. So there are no arrows at all from the Rn plus 1, let's say, to Rn or things like that. It is just completely. Yeah, right. Well, they will. There are no arrows at all. So that's one remark I want to make. And the second thing I want to say is that something that is nice to know later is that you look at the Tn, which is finite and free over that ring, then actually Tn is finite and free over that algebra. Of rank equal to the rank by Nakayama's lemma. If you mod out by the ideal S1 up to SR, then you find by the first property the ring T, and the ring T is finite and flat over O, and the ranks are equal. So the ranks as algebras over these rings of all these Tn's are the same, and they are equal to the rank, the O rank of T, where T is the ring at the bottom. Oops. Now I want to give you a proof of this criterion. Yeah, proof. And the first remark is that in order to prove this, you may as well, it suffices to prove this modulo pi, where pi is the uniformizer of O. Now, let me explain why that is so. So we have a surjection from R to T, and the kernel is a certain ideal J, and we know that T is flat over O. So if I tensor this over the rest of the residue field, is K, that I already introduced, if I tensor this over K with O, then I get again an exact sequence. And if I know that this is an isomorphism, then I know that this is zero. That means that J modulo pi of J is zero. But now I can make this ideal a little bit larger. I can That certainly implies that if I take the maximal ideal of the algebra R rather than the algebra O, then this is a quotient. This is even more zero. And since the ring is Noetherian, J is finitely generated, I can apply Nakayama's lemma, which I will do several more times, and I find that J is zero. So we find that we have an isomorphism here. So that is one thing. If I have an isomorphism modulo pi, then I actually have an isomorphism. And if I know that R or T modulo pi is a complete intersection, so if I know that I have an exact sequence, intersection, complete intersection in the sense of yesterday with O replaced by K, if I have So if T modulo pi is a complete intersection in this sense, I have a, what I can do is I can map then, I can map O Y1 up to YR surjectively to T by Nakayama's lemma again, and I have a certain kernel here. So another J, and then what I can do is I can tensor the sequence below with K, which is again exact because T is flat, and then I have isomorphisms everywhere. Then I see that this is isomorphic to that, so I can lift the F1s into the ideal J. And then you have that the ideal generated by F1 up to FR is contained in J, and there is a quotient. And it is clear that if you tensor this with K, then the quotient tensor K is zero. The quotient is finitely generated by Nakayama's lemma. It has to be zero. So we conclude that J is actually the same as F1 up to FR. So that shows that it is enough to prove this modulo pi. If I prove this modulo pi by some standard arguments, I have it in general. So then what we do? We take the theorem and we take everything that is written there modulo pi. And we try to prove that. Notice that in that case, the element omega n, so modulo pi, the element 1 plus s, I forgot to say that p is the characteristic of little k. So p is divisible by pi, and 1 plus s to the p to the n minus 1 is then simply equal to s to the p to the n modulo pi. So all these elements here in this ideal become simply powers of the variables. Now we are going to make the rings smaller. So, he wins. Okay, so now we are going to replace these diagrams by diagrams that are where the rings are smaller. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to replace R by R modulo its maximal ideal times the kernel of the map from R to T. This is a quotient of my ring R, and all the conditions will still be satisfied that if I have such diagrams With my new R, they will have the same properties. That is very easy to see. And this has the advantage that, well, first of all, it's okay to do this, because if I show now that R modulo MR modulo the kernel is isomorphic to T induced by F, then it follows that MR times the kernel contains the kernel, and then by Nakayama, we know that the kernel is trivial. But that's okay. We can make this replacement. And what's the point of doing this? Well, the point is this ring is smaller, much smaller a priori than R, because it sits in an exact sequence like this. I can apply F to this and go to T. And the kernel of this map will be the kernel of the original map modulo this. Okay, now this is, oh, excuse me, I tend to use the same notation, but I remember that now everything is modulo pi. So everything here, you have to tensor it with a residue class field. I use the same notation. So that's just to create confusion. Same notation, everything mod pi. That means that this T now is finite, because it was a finite rank over O. So if I take it modulo the uniformizer, this thing is finite. It is a finite O algebra. And this is also finite, because it is the kernel of F is finitely generated because R is Noetherian. And if I take it modulo this maximal ideal, it becomes also finite. So this is finite as well, because the residue is a finite dimension over K. Since K is finite, it is finite. So this ring now is finite. And that's the reason for doing this. R now is finite. Now, we make a few more substitutions that are harmless in the sense that they do not affect the conditions there. We replace also Tn by Tn modulo J, where J was this ideal that was contained in the, was a small ideal contained in the ideal generated by the omegas. That also doesn't affect my list of conditions. So now I know that Tn itself is actually free over K S1 up to Sr modulo S1 to the P to the N up to Sr to the P to the N of rank equal to the dimension of T over K. So that's what we do also as well. And finally, we replace Rn by its image. Rn maps to both Tn and to R, and I replace it by its image in Rn times, no, in R times Tn. Now, since I didn't say that, but it follows from that argument, R is also a finite rank over O. So, excuse me?
You want to replace Tn by Tn over S1 to the P to the N to Sr to the P to the N. J was the thing that anyhow was zero.
Excuse me, thank you. Yeah. Thank you. R is finite. Tn is finite, because they are finite rank over this ring. But this ring has finite dimension over K. So Tn has finite dimension over K as well. And since K is finite, this is finite. So this is finite, this is finite. This is the image in there. It is also finite. And we still have diagrams of this sort, Rn going surjectively to R to T. Everything is still surjective. The properties are still satisfied. And these are diagrams of finite rings. Oh, finite, yeah, K vector space, K algebras. That's what I have now. For every N, I have such a diagram. Okay, there's one thing now that I want to compute. Oops. So let's look at Tn, which is free of rank equal to the dimension over k of T tensor k over that algebra there, which is k s1 up to sr modulo p1 s1 to the pn sr to the pn. So it is an algebra finite rank over this thing. And you can actually compute what its cardinality is. The cardinality of Tn, it's easy, no? It is the cardinality of this ring to that power. That's what it is. So in this notation, it becomes equal to the cardinality of T to the power P to the nr. And the cardinality of Rn is also bounded, of course. It is less than the cardinality of Tn times the cardinality of R. So this is bounded in terms of n. OK, now I define an n structure like as follows. So I define an n structure to be such a collection of commutative diagrams of k algebras that satisfy my list of properties. So I know that Rn modulo the Sn's, just write them one more time for you. I will just write the same, that this is R, Tn modulo this ideal is T. The ring Rn admits a surjection by this power series ring, this time with coefficients in k. And the ring Tn is free of rank equal to the rank of T over O over that algebra there. That's what I have. Now notice, if I have an N structure, and if N prime is less than or equal to N, I can make from this an n prime structure. What do? You just take everything more. Oh, I forgot to write the ideal here. Excuse me? Yes, thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you. I can make an n prime structure. The only thing you need to do is take everything modulo S1 to the P to the N prime up to SR to the P to the N prime. And since Tn was free of this rank over this algebra, it will now be free of the same rank over the algebra modulo this ideal rather than that ideal. So there is, you have these compatibilities between these N structures. You can make such maps. And in fact, I define now what is a morphism of N structures. So a morphism, this is a rather ad hoc notion, I should say. A morphism of N structures is a commutative diagram as follows. So if you have an Rn and a Tn, it goes surjectively to R and T. It is the obvious thing, of course. You have another one, R n prime and T n prime, that have the same properties. Then I want two arrows here, and this should be commutative. Moreover, I want that the morphism from K x1 to xr to R n, that algebra homomorphism that is given to Rn, that is surjective, There is also one given to Rn prime, and this should be compatible also. So if you have all that, then that is a morphism of n structures. And an isomorphism of n structures, you can guess what that is, I guess. Now, we make an obvious observation. There are only finitely many isomorphism classes of n structures. That's clear, because all these rings there, except the power series ring, are finite. So there are only finitely many maps between them. And a morphism from the power series ring to Rn is just given by specifying R elements. And that is also, it's maybe big, but it is a finite number of choices. So you have finitely many n structures. Now that you can use to construct a compatible family of n structures. So construct compatible series or sequence of n structures in an obvious way. So you have all these n structures there. For every integer you have one. You take them all modulo S1 to the P up to SR to the P. And then you get one structures, infinitely many one structures. Since there are only finitely many isomorphism classes, one isomorphism class will contain infinitely many isomorphic ones. So they will contain n structures that give rise to infinitely many isomorphic one structures. And I take one of those. And then I repeat the story. And then I take it modulo S1 P squared up to SR P squared. And I go on like that. Yeah? So I get... Okay. So I have infinitely many n structures because there are infinitely many integers. Now I take them modulo S1 to the P, SR to the P. As I explained there, that gives rise to one structures. Get infinitely many one structures. There are only finitely many isomorphism classes. Here the n is fixed. That is important. There are only finitely many isomorphism classes. So there are infinitely many n that give rise to isomorphic one structures. So there is a set, there is an infinite set, omega of integers n, that give rise to the same one structure. They give rise in that way there. And now I repeat it. I have, again, infinitely many n structures. Now I take them modulo S1 to the P squared, SR to the P squared. And I get, since my set is infinite, infinitely many two structures. And because there are only finitely many isomorphism classes, infinitely many of them will give rise to the same isomorphism class, and I go on. Now it's clear? Okay. So I get now a series of... I really have a tower. I get a system. So I have R that goes to T over O, and I have all these arrows here. Since everywhere I have this big power series ring that maps surjective to in a compatible way because of my notion of isomorphism. So all these maps between the Rn's are surjective.
You replace your old Rn with the
It's still over K.
But the compatible ones you made, you've thrown away some.
Yeah, 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 okay. So I call them, yeah, you're right, yeah. So I take, there is an infinite set that gives rise to the same n structure. Okay, so I pick one, n1, no? Pick one, n2, and then this is really Rn1 that goes to Tn1, and this is Rn2 goes to Tn2, like that. That's better, right? Okay. Now, all these maps to these R are surjective because of the property of this power series ring that maps surjectively, and since the Rn's to the Tn's are surjective, all the Rn, all the O-morphisms that we have, O-algebra-morphisms, are actually surjections. And we know that each of these rings here is free. So let's pick, this one is free of rank, of some rank, the O-rank of T over the algebra K S1 up to SR over S1 to the P to the N, SR to the P to the, or to the I, I should say, the shoe. If I'm at level NI, that would be it. Here? Yeah, you're right. Great, yeah. So we have this diagram, and now we can take a limit. Now, it's compatible, so I'm going to take the limit. And now it's all very easy to conclude the argument. We take the limit and it is easy to see that you get the limit of the Rn's that map to the limit of the Tn's, and you still have a surjection here of this power series ring in R variables. And this power series ring has a priori absolutely nothing to do with the other power series ring that we have here, which is a projective limit of the algebra in the variables S modulo these ideals, and which you can show now maps injectively to this ring. And it is easy to see that now this one is free over that ring, that algebra of that rank. So now what do we have? If I concentrate my attention to this ring, then I see that the Krull dimension of that ring is at most the Krull dimension of this ring, which is R. That is because of the surjection. On the other hand, it is free over this algebra. So in particular, it is faithfully flat. And that means that the Krull dimension of this algebra is at least the Krull dimension of this ring, which is also R. So it is so it must be equal to R. And now let's look at this map here. We have this power series ring, it has Krull dimension R, it maps to this ring, which also has Krull dimension R. It is well known that since this is a domain, if you would have a non-trivial kernel, then the dimension of, or it is trivial, that the dimension of this ring necessarily would have to be strictly smaller than R. Since this doesn't happen, the only explanation is that this is an isomorphism. And the same here, of course. Of course, I can repeat the same argument here. So I have isomorphisms everywhere. So I find that the projective limit of those R's are isomorphic to the projective limits of these Tn's, And this is all isomorphic to a power series ring. In the variables R. Now what we do is we take this modulo the ideal S1 up to SR. Now what happens if you take one of our rings Rn or Tn modulo this ideal, then you would reobtain the rings at the bottom of the tower. And that also happens if you apply this to the limit. So if I do that, what I get is that R is isomorphic to T, and it is just also isomorphic to this ring modulo these. And this is a complete intersection. So you are now in the... You will see in the proof that the construction of the axis is very indirect. There is a you compute a cohomology group, and you find that these rings can be generated by R elements, but you don't have explicit generators for the axis. On the other hand, the S's are the diamond operators, essentially. You construct them with the diamond operators, so you know exactly what they are in some sense. So you have the situation that you know that R is isomorphic to T, and that it is a complete intersection ring. You have no idea what the generators are, but you know what the relations are. This is equal to this. Well, I finish early. I've given you the complete proof, and I think I just stop here.